is Charles van der Heuvel, the Research Group Professor of Science and Scholarship at the Huygens Institute for the History of the Netherlands. It's a pleasure to welcome you to the sixth edition of the Huygens-Descartes Lecture, also on behalf of Professor Meinhardt, the Director of the Descartes Center, with whom we always organize these events and returns. It's an honor to introduce Professor Jacob Soll, Professor of History and Accounting of the University of Southern California, author of several publications on the relation between intellectual history and accountability, well known for his publication Information Master about the Secret Intelligence System under the French Minister of Finance, who actually which we discussed when the two institutes, the Huygens Institute and the Institute of the History of the Netherlands, merged. So we had very inspirational discussions actually about your book and made part of our research program also together with Weinand, who was scientific advisor to our organization. So your book already has been used quite a lot, I must say. Very interesting book about gathering knowledge to support the state of France, and also with some comparisons to other states like Italy, and very brief remarks about the Netherlands. But according to Kettle, so it's currently Jacob Soll is working on a comparative study on the role of accountability and nation building, and a lot of the countries actually he will be working on his publishing on this on the Netherlands. This book will come out next year, correct? And today we will already give a little clip of the chapter of that book about the Dutch situation with this lecture. The awakening of how the Dutch invented political accountability 1500 to 1800. So we'll talk for about 45 to 50 minutes, and then we can take a couple of questions, and then we will have a good talk.
Thanks to Charles and to Binan. It's nice to be here as always. Good to be back in the Dutch Republic. Those of us who study early modern history, Dutch Republicanism still stands as an inspiration. What I wanted to do today, I'm not a Dutch historian. I'm kind of a French historian, a little more of an Italian historian. But what I've been doing over the past several years is trying to understand historically the phenomenon of accountability, financial and political accountability. Within the histories of capitalism and economics, and indeed of science, we have histories of authority, we have histories of proof, we have histories of trust, histories of testimony. But I was very sort of shocked as I did my own studies to find that there weren't really histories, indeed cultural histories, of accountability. This became, I think, more pressing in 2007 and 2008 during the world financial crisis when no one was held accountable. And I sort of looked around expecting someone to be held accountable, and no one was held accountable. And I thought, wow, we have a cultural problem with accountability. It's not just an issue of a history that hasn't been written. It's still a cultural problem that challenges us today. At that time, I was studying Louis XIV and Jean-Baptiste Colbert, and I was studying how Colbert actually taught Louis XIV double-entry bookkeeping. And I thought, oh, this is a very unique moment where this dynastic Catholic king actually studies a double-entry book manual. But what I was more surprised to find is that once Louis XIV had mastered double-entry accounting, and Colbert had put in place for him the beginnings of a very modern system. When Colbert died in 1683, Louis XIV dismantled and destroyed the entire system that Colbert had built. And as we spoke about in Utrecht yesterday, this undermined the French state terribly. It never really recovered from this dismantling of any capacity within the state to do complex accounting and to hold anyone accountable. Louis XIV did not want to be accountable to anyone. Really, in the end, only to God, whom he feared terribly. And so I started looking around to try and find a genealogy of accountability, already aware that accountability is a word which is connected accounting, and is therefore connected to finance. And I was already deeply aware of the role of accounting in at least the Christian tradition, in St. Matthew, although that's a Judeo-Greek Christian tradition, who's very vague. I actually blame St. Matthew for a number of our financial problems, because he, at the same time, says, you know, you should have money and make more money. He also says, I turned away from the trading table and I went with Jesus. And so there are two messages in St. Matthew. One is that the poor should be celebrated by God, and the other is you should do good financial management. It's not clear, actually, which one. Unless you have your own reading of St. Matthew, I'd be interested to know. The Bible is filled with books of judgment, filled with reckoning days, filled with God counting souls. As we know, the Catholic Church will also start counting sins and making their own treasury of sin. St. Augustine actually says that Christ is a merchant who gave his blood in exchange for the sins of mankind, and that the Church then claimed to hold this blood treasury of sin, which could be constantly exchanged. And there was always this idea from late antiquity onwards of this exchange or this balance that would finally be made, a kind of trade for one's soul. And, so this was within a Christian tradition, something vague but nonetheless very strong. And I was aware of that. And so I wanted to look deeper for this genealogy, for to see if there is a culture of accountability rather than people who are accountable. There's actually a moment. And I went to Italy and I spent a lot of time in the Florentine archives in particular. And I was very impressed, not only with their invention of double entry, but how, for example, people like the Medici were so skilled in accounting. I was also very impressed at how the Florentines in particular began to lose the capacity for accountability as their culture changed with Neoplatonism from a merchant culture to a merchant and aristocratic culture starting in 1494 with the invasions of the French and the Spanish on the Italian peninsula. And I began to actually trace the decline of a culture of accounting and accountability in Italy. And this was fascinating, and this led me to Pacioli, Luca Pacioli's first manual on accounting. And everyone considers this the most important sort of singular moment in the history of accounting. I, while studying this history, and I think it will become clear today when I discuss the Dutch, found that this was actually a moment of failure. Pacioli publishes his book. It's a common knowledge book, the actual chapter on accounting, on computing, that chapter is called. It's a manual that you can get in any accounting school in Italy. But he publishes the book as part of a Neoplatonic mathematical work, his Summa on Arithmetic, which is about celestial and divine mathematics. And as a Neoplatonist from Tuscany, he believes that obviously mathematics are part of this quest for human perfection and understanding the universe, which will bring humans closer to God. But he also believes, and this comes from a particular culture that he is from, that practical merchant mathematics is also part of this phenomenon. However, in his oration on the dignity of man, Pico della Mirandola specifically contradicts this. And he says, divine arithmetic includes everything but the arithmetic of merchants. And so there is actually a break. And as we get into the 1500s, you find a massive decline in the circulation of accounting manuals. There's only one Italian translation in 1540 of Pacioli. Most German merchants, for example, have to go to Venice, to the Fondaco de Tedeschi, which is now a Benetton superstore, to learn accounting. And they have their own relationship with accounting, but even the Fugger House is unable to balance its books in a professional way, under Matthias Schwarz, who can't do it. We've seen his books. And so I was sort of stunned by this decline of accounting culture. There was never an ideology. There was never a treatise, a theoretical treatise. There was never a grand statement about accounting in Renaissance Italy, indeed, in Spain. And I was amazed because this is supposed to be one of the great inventions of the West. And so it never created an ideology as far as inventions go, like defenders. I went deep into the Spanish administration of Charles V and Philip II, and I found remarkable accounting reforms, considering that there were only a handful of people in Spain who could do double entry bookkeeping, a few of them in the Casa de Contratación in Seville, but they had no schools for accounting. Until 1590, they had no manual for accounting. Philip II does remarkable accounting reforms. He sets up, under Juan de Ovando, numerous accounting sections of the government. He wants a central ledger of the entire state, but he himself is repulsed by accounting. This is an amazing thing. And he actually says, at a certain point, they come to him and they say, here are the books. And he says, I do not want to, nor will I ever try and wrap my head around something which I dislike so much. And this is not for me. I'm king. I will not look at the central ledger of the country. And in fact, I will not follow the reforms through. This is very Philip II. He does a giant project, the most innovative project, and then he kind of lets it drop. He's such a strange figure, Philip II. And so as I studied these things, the more I saw accounting not as a kind of symbol of capitalist success, as Weber and other of the great economists have seen it, but as something that is necessary and works, but constantly fails. It's constantly failing. And so I continued looking, and I knew obviously that the Dutch were good accountants, but what I didn't realize, and this is what I want to sort of explain today, the Dutch became not only responsible for the circulation of double entry accounting, but one of the reasons that this happened was there was a more general culture of accounting and accountability in Holland, which was completely unique. It constantly failed, but it managed to sort of stay afloat for basically 200 or more years, more than 200 years. It's the longest running culture in the West that managed to harness accounting and use it for both finance and for government in a remarkable way. One of the first things, and I just wanted to sort of start with this, that the Dutch did was that not only, I'm going to explain this, not only did the Dutch start translating accounting books and create an educational culture very much around accounting, but they recognize it as part of their lives, and they spend a great deal of energy, more than anyone else, actually looking at and examining accounting. First of all, they celebrate it in paintings like this. There are numerous accounting paintings in the Dutch tradition, and some celebrate it, some show how accounting works. But they also do something else. Sorry about the low quality of this slide. This is an amazing, this is Jan Provost's painting, which is an amazing painting because it shows very fine double entry books, which you can't see here. And it shows someone, this is a very St. Matthew style painting, because it shows someone who is rich, a rich merchant, who has succeeded. And on the other side of this, of these panels, it shows him with various saints and his city being a good civic and pious merchant. He keeps good books, but at the end of the day, he can't fill in that last entry his finger is on because the man who owes him the debt is dead, and in the end, only death will settle the debt. And what is remarkable, there emerges in Holland a genre of warning paintings about accounting. And they're very, very Dutch in the sense that they both show you how to do it. They both celebrate the fact that the Dutch are always very good at these technical things, but there are danger constantly lurking. One of the most interesting things is the evolution of this painting by Metsys, which starts as a pious painting. You see the wife has a pious book, this money counter. It becomes a book of
accounting, okay? These are still books that are now, it goes from piety to this Dutch celebration of artisanal skill, which we know is a unique and remarkable tradition. I was at the Rijks Museum today, as usual, just stunned. But it also, I've got some more bad slides to show you about this. This is a French question, that's what this is, I think, common culture. It starts becoming a strong warning about human hubris. So it doesn't just show the professional side, it shows the side of hubris. And this is meddling, my favorite. I'm sorry about that. This is Tommaso Portinari, and who is the head accountant for the Bruges branch of the Medici house. It is his fault that the Medici Bank, it is not his fault, it is partially his fault that the Medici Bank collapses. He gives a loan of 6,000 groats to the Duke of Burgundy, Charles, who doesn't pay him back. This totally destroys the bank, and he actually commissions this painting the very year he makes the loan. I think it's 1571, I think I'm right about this. And Memling has him being weighed by St. Michael, and this is Judgment Day, and people are being, in the rest of the painting, being sent to heaven and to hell, and he's being balanced. And everyone knows in the end where he goes, he loses everything, and he really, at least in the world of Italian bankers and of Dutch merchants, he goes to hell, because he destroys the Medici Bank, or partially does it. More than this, there's Van Reymer's Fallas, big tradition. This is one of numerous paintings which take that older image from Matisse and turn it into these money changers, keeping books. Notice paper is a little bit more messy, but nonetheless, this is a technology which the Dutch are very good at. Now we have a twisted man. There are some other images which there have been arguments about if it's an anti-Semitic image. I'm not convinced that it is, but there is this image of warning. You can be very skilled, you can do this well, and again, there are numerous versions of this, but be careful. This is the only society that is actually showing accounting and its technology, how it works, and warning people about it. And the warnings, by the way, were in the 17th century. It's really in the 16th century that you get all the warning paintings. But this, of all the images, is actually by German and Swiss engraver and writer. This is, I think everybody knows, the Allegory of Commerce from 1585, which is a sort of remarkable image because it shows at the very moment that Antwerp is about to fall and frankly be destroyed as the center of world commerce, destroyed by the Spanish. It shows Antwerp in the background, its ships, it shows its trade. There's Mars over the balance of Fortuna, the goddess of fortune, on either side of the debit and credit books are the journal and the memoriale, and in the middle she stands on a ledger. And here is a technical description of how to do double entry, showing it and explaining it. There's no other culture that actually did this. Now, whether or not the Germans and the Swiss produced this, this represented this Flemish Dutch might, which people in Europe clearly recognized as being based on a technology, a capacity to manage double entry accounting. There's really nothing like this. It is a full manual, which really even shows, this is the most amazing, because this shows the memoriale. It shows merchants actually putting receipts, gluing the receipts into books, which is the first step. And it explains in German every step of the way. I could actually also cite numerous poems which actually talk about the mighty Dutch having their power based on double entry. Those who understood commerce understood that the Dutch had mastered this thing. The Dutch themselves were very aware of its place, and at least for a time, very aware of the dangers of accounting, which any accountant today will tell you is the first thing you must know in accounting, that it's not exact, that it's very delicate, and that it's very almost dangerous. You need it, but it's dangerous to count on. This is completely unique in human culture. Even the Chinese did not do this, as I have to say in America over and over again. Huygens did not do this, even not even close, I'm afraid. This is quite remarkable, but it's just the beginning for the Dutch. And that, I think, is even more impressive, because what the Dutch will then do is go beyond just thinking about accounting, but they will create very consciously a culture of accounting and accountability, just like those warning paintings show. And it's a really remarkable culture. And I'm sure people in this room know better than I do, starting in the early 1500s, a number of accounting schools, they're called French schools, because of the old Burgundian tax collection tradition in the Netherlands. They spring up all over the Netherlands, in particular in Antwerp, but we find them in other cities as well. And we have a remarkable, documentation about the rise of the Dutch accounting schools. In fact, even in 1503, we find that Jacob van Schoenhoven from Bruges receives a license from the burgomasters of Amsterdam to teach reading, writing, and arithmetic and French. This is an accounting school to anyone who is interested. 1503, the city is already investing in this. This is completely unique, okay? We get this in Italy as well, but it's not as systematic, where each city is now making sure it has an accounting school. We also know that there are Handelsscholen in all over the Netherlands. There are a number of famous accounting masters who emerge. There are some Germans who actually know how to do it well, actually come to the Netherlands to do this. And as we know, around 1585, Jan Impin will write a manual based on Pacioli's work in Dutch. His wife will publish it after the Spanish siege of Antwerp in Amsterdam. We also know from the founding of accounting schools that after 1585, the real center of accounting moves from Antwerp to Amsterdam, as a huge number of, a huge percentage of the population flees Antwerp and goes to Amsterdam, many of the merchants. This is a remarkable sort of shift in the culture. Now, traced the most important books, the books which then get translated into English back into French, that book will actually be the book that spreads accounting in Northwestern Europe. Why is that important? And also in Germany, in the German states, because this is really where trade will be centered after the 1500s. So one thing I stand by here, it's not the Italians who spread accounting, they invent double entry, that's important, but the Dutch create not only a culture to support this, but a number of schools and manuals which explain it, but also a culture where outsiders want to emulate the Dutch, which is what this is actually all about, and therefore they start reading the Dutch accounting manuals. It will be by the Dutch that this spreads. That is something which in the history of capitalism and finance, we have not seen that before. This is very, very important. Without the Dutch, the Italian invention does not go anywhere. And I think this is remarkable. But the Dutch would go even further. I think everybody here obviously knows the history of Simon Stevin. I actually know how to say it in Dutch because I was educated in France, and of course, the French will always find a way to Frenchify Simon Stevin. It sounds like a French name. But he is really a remarkable figure because not only does he write a famous Dutch double entry manual, not only is he a skilled technical engineering humanist and also a philologist and linguist, but he becomes the first theorist of double entry. And in his Verstelke bookholding, which is Amsterdam 1604, he describes this remarkable moment where he teaches Prince Maurits how to do double entry. And he explains that the prince says, this is very hard, this is very interesting, but we know from that they went to university together, that they knew each other at university. Again, there's no other country where this can happen, where a low-born accountant goes to school with a prince, where they become friends, and where in 1593, I think this is the date that this happens, I'm not sure exactly, he sits down and teaches him double entry. The prince learns it, and what Charles was showing me today is that the prince keeps double entry accounts, he uses it for administration, and he has his own personal, we can call it, royal account book, which is what Stevin called it to begin with. This is the first time in history that this happens. The Dutch do it, and they do it with a theory. Stevin, in his book, says, why do all these bureaucrats always steal, we find that they steal money? Why do we find governments always in debt? It is because we don't have good accountants, and we don't have a final auditor, someone to actually show them, do an audit. So we don't have anyone to actually do the final audit. The prince must make this audit. And this is a revolutionary statement to begin with. And he teaches his prince to do it. And it actually happens. I mean, you have the theory, you have the practice. This is a very important moment. Even more than that, we have the work of Caspar Varlaeus, who really becomes, in some sense, the ideologue of the nascent Dutch Republic. There's the remarkable, I don't have the images here, but they're amazing. His book on Marie de Medici's entrance into Amsterdam in 1638 celebrates this queen, this they call her daughter of Cosmo, even though it's another branch of the family. She's a Medici. Coming to Holland, they bring her to the Dutch East India House, where Albertus the burgomaster of Amsterdam shows her the pepper stalks, the cinnamon sticks, the rhubarb, the sugar cane, the gunpowder, the saltpeter, all decoratively done, by the way. It's a remarkable description. They make pyramids out of these things. Then they give her a Reichstafel, they actually say this. She's obviously amazed, because no one's ever seen this. And this is the beginning. But then the book turns. It doesn't just celebrate this French queen, daughter of the Medici coming to Amsterdam. It actually says, it actually challenges monarchy as a system. And Varlaeus says, our republic spreads as far as the sun shines. This is an echo of the Spanish play. And it does this because of commerce, work, and industry. So beyond, but then he goes beyond a Protestant discourse. And he says, here with Marie de Medici, for the first time, monarchy has come face to face with the grandeur of industry and international trade. And he says that this great company, the Dutch East India Company, is like a prince. And basically, he makes the point that this prince has managed to despoil the king of Spain. So this is this moment where he literally talks about Republican industry and knowledge beating out monarchy. In 1632, in Mercator Sapiens, which is another theoretical book about the learned merchant, he actually goes further. And he defends the mixture of humanist learning with the merchant arts. This is taken with Stevin's work. I actually say that this is an intellectual tradition or an ideology which is built in Holland that is completely unique. Varlaeus says commercial, practical knowledge, such as navigation, geography, geometry, mathematics, go hand in hand with the more classical, higher humanist arts. And he actually says that the greatest virtue of civic life, the people who will make the country the best, will be just, wise merchant managers who create reasoned politics and abundant commerce. So now we've gone even away from the idea of the royal accountant, really, to the idea of the princely company. I mean, he calls the BOC company, prince, who by merchant knowledge will take over the world. Now, I just want to back up. This is already amazing. In the history of political thought, by the way, none of these books have ever really been recognized as works of political thought. They don't enter into the Cambridge, every talk I give, I will criticize the Cambridge canon of blue books that just decide, just like the Catholic Church used to decide, which, and any church, which were the holy books that you should read. None of these Dutch books are in those collections. It took, actually, our friend Jan Bazing to make an English critical translation of the Politica, which they never considered an actual book of political theory because it's filled with maxims, because they're looking at things like this, okay? This is why I think you have to do a wider cultural history. But the wider cultural history also makes us ask, why do the Dutch make this work? We know from the work of Oscar Gelderblom and Manja Fritsche and other very fine Dutch economic historians that there is a lot of double entry floating around the Dutch Republic. We know, and I don't know this in the same kind of detail, that there is some double entry being used in provincial tax receipts, but there is great trust amount around the provincial tax receipts. There is trust that the money will be collected, that the books will be kept, and that the numbers that are given will be right, and I do believe that people have the technical right to audit those tax receipts now and then, although it doesn't necessarily happen. There is a possibility for accountability. For, is it 150 years, the Dutch set lending interest rates in Europe due to the stability of these state accounts. There's this remarkable culture of competency, of state financial management on one hand, and that's also the contour, on financier. They also do a much more professional job than anyone else in Europe is doing. There's enormous trust around this. And this is not surprising in a culture where many people walk out of Latin school in Dordrecht and they walk into their accounting school. And we have evidence that this actually happens. Now, we talked about, there was a conference that we were all at some of us were at in France a couple of years ago, where we discussed this, and one of the ideas, well, where did the Dutch get this not only quality that they ask for accountability, we know that they do accounting better than anyone else, but they also ask for audits, and in many cases they're willing to be audited. There is no other culture where this is a generalized trait. One idea might be the water boards, which have to be well managed, have to keep their accounts well. There's actually a local culture of financial management and bookkeeping and accountability to keep the water boards working. And we know Stefan actually is the overseer of some of this. Obviously, whoever doesn't manage the water well dies in Holland, so there's a lot of pressure to actually do this. There are also, of course, the Dutch almshouse, local almshouse tradition, in which accounting is apparently used at a high level. There seems to be a civic tradition of accounting and accountability being perhaps the most important thing here, where audits are demanded, but there is also a level of trust that doesn't exist in other places to the same extent. This could be one reason, or part of a whole that the Dutch seem to be able to actually have accounting and to have accountability. We know from the charter of the Dutch East India Company that there are rules about yearly, that accounts should be kept, quote, in the manner of merchants or stewards. I can't remember which one they say, I think it's merchants, and that there should be yearly accounts given, that the bevindhebbers are supposed to actually give accounts. We know that in the 1620s, when the company, when the vintners start raiding the company and stealing, and the company returns start dropping, that there is this singular moment, in the first moment in human history, where we have the first shareholders revolt or complaint in the Nutwendig Discourse, the necessary discourse, which attacks the Heron 17 and the Vintners and asks for open audits, a proper accounting, a reckoning in the manner of stewards and merchants, and in fact makes this incredible statement, necessary discourse, which is an amazing document, which says there has been no audit. Everything has remained obscure, and they haven't come up with anything but procrastination and excuses instead of the Reckonbuch, which, as we suspect, they had smeared with bacon and which was eaten by the dogs. It is said that only someone who has something to conceal hides, but an honest rendering of accounts can bear the light of day. When our ancestors, Adam and Eve, hid and tried to conceal themselves on the fig leaves, they were unable to account to God for taking bites of an apple. Now, the dissenting participants of the East India Company set everyone thinking whether all suspicion can be removed in this way from the hearts of pious people. And they call for a strict series of accounts. I think, again, as people in this room know, the company refuses due to, reason of state. They can't expose their accounts with the Spanish around, but they do end up setting up an accountant who does an audit, and people trust that audit. Later, Johannes Hood, the famous mathematician, very famous mathematician, is set to reorganize the accounting of the Dutch East India Company. This is a remarkable thing. He fails, although he tries very hard. Very interesting to see him try. One of the reasons he fails is his accountants keep dying, or getting corrupted, or disappearing on boats at sea. He's trying to get this done. This is, history shows that this is a very, very hard thing to do. So even when the Dutch fail, the language of accounting and accountability comes back. Maybe they don't fully pull it off, but they try, they set up these offices, and they use a language which no one in the world uses, and they seem to use it in a very familiar way, and in a very public way, which is also unique. Finally, I just wanted to talk about the sort of last part of this moment, when we get Peter de la Cour writing his True Interest in Maxims of Holland, another book which is not very well known. There hasn't been a modern edition, and we need one, which is a book defending republicanism that is so strong and so inspiring that it seems almost modern. It uses classical language, I think giving very, very strong evidence to John Pocock's old Republican theory, but most of the book is actually trade receipts from various port cities in Holland. So you have classical discourses about virtue and republicanism and openness and tolerance, but then mostly numbers from basically audits of receipts in courts. This is a remarkable book too. This is a very, very modern book. I would actually call this, truly in its physical form, a method, the precursor to Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations. Because Smith, a moralist, will go into the medieval account books in England and in France and actually use the account books to create part of his moralistic free trade theory, which is more or less what this book is as well. There's a deep connection to these things. Finally, of course, there is the connection with the De Witt, with Jan De Witt. This is, I think, in the history of humanity, the first time that a top mathematician and financial analyst becomes the head of the state. As we all know, he comes up with the first true modern annuities calculations. He also writes a famous book on the physics of curves. This, in some ways, could be seen as the summum, the final moment of modernity and rationalism, where the great Platonic mathematician rises to the head of being of this great merchant republic. But of course, as we know, there's a prince lurking in this strange Dutch relationship between republics and princes, which I still think you guys have to struggle with a little bit. And this is what happens to the De Witt brothers. Okay? In the great tradition of Dutch food still life, we have them gutted and ready to be roasted, more or less. We know that the internal organs of John De Witt were kept in a box in a shopkeeper's house for several years after this. So how do we conclude this odd and crazy story about Dutch accountability? I mean, the first thing I think is that there's nothing like this. I think it's incontestable that this exists. I think it's also incontestable that it's remarkably rich, it's deep, but that in the end, the Dutch do not pull together a final reckoning, a final modern system, even though their system is good compared to many others. It still is a system in flux, which they struggle over. What we do know is that the same question will be struggled over by the English, who really start perfecting them, and this brings us back to religion. It's really the dissenters and some Baconian mathematicians who are high politicians that start spreading accounting culture in England. By the end of the 18th century, I believe there are more than 1,000 accounting schools in England, making England the center of accounting culture. I could talk to you an hour about the rise of accounting culture in America, which comes in a very strange way. Some of it through Dutch settlers, but most of it actually comes through this old dissenting Presbyterian tradition. In any case, it becomes the foundation of Republican constitutions. The American Constitution has an accounting clause. The French Revolution, revolutionary constitutions have accounting clauses. I don't actually know about the modern Dutch constitution, but most modern constitutions have accounting clauses in them. What I can say is whether this works or not, because right now, as we know, we're struggling with this, whether it works or not, the Dutch did, I think, at least invent it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this amazing talk. I was wondering, are there questions?
But I mean, as a Republican, you can just call me by my first name.
Okay, my name is Jorge. And also, I have one suggestion to make as to your account of accountability. And that is the limited liability. The company was launched in Holland, you didn't mention that.
Yes.
And what is the most typical for that? I work in a bank where the issuing department had to be your vote. And what I learned is that when you issue securities, you have a unit deciding on the issue on one side with the advice of some financial people. And you have a wide distribution of paper that's not organized. That came only in the 19th century. There were no groups of shareholders acting on behalf of everybody. So the Dutch East India Company, who issued shares, created the power to postpone accountability because they could say, you have the shares, it's in your interest to be paid.
That's right. I do say that.
And that is one important side note to your issue. The second is that before 1600, and I think that era is very important, there was the royalty as power at the top. French religious wars, and we are still in the second trying to prop up Roman Catholicism. Authority of God was with him. And when the Republicans came, and the limited liability companies, there came doubt, but also the power to cost from. I want to suggest that you put that into your next question.
I thank you, it's actually in the book. And what I say that the limited liability company cannot exist without the cultural accountability, but it doesn't completely work. I mean, this is this Dutch thing, it's a kind of amazing and first attempt, but it's also befuddled. And of course, we know with Isaac Le Maire and all the people who are doing all the bizarre, dishonest things around the company, people are stealing from it. When there are calls to follow the charter, the company doesn't do it, and it says precisely it's in your interest that we do not do this for lots of reasons. Some that you have also, many of the shareholders cheated and made money doing some insider speculation, big insider speculation. We have evidence of that. But nonetheless, the very language that's being thrown back and forth is unique. I also would say that when we write the history of the first limited publicly traded company, limited liability company, it is possible only in a culture not just of trust, but where there is this possibility to fight over accountability. In a monarchy, you can't really fight over it. And there are all these accounting reforms in places like France in the 17th century, very specific ones where Colbert has laws that everyone should keep double entry books. The Packy brothers in the early 1700s put posters on the wall showing how to do double entry. But it's in a culture where no one knows what it is and everyone feels deeply uncomfortable with it.
Because of the royal authority. Of course, read Michelin and you'll find out what happened after Colbert.
I know very well. I've lived in those archives for several years and it's not pretty. But I can tell
you. Interesting, because the end of the story is revolution.
Yes, that's absolutely right. Actually, the end of the story is, I think, the most interesting part is Benjamin Franklin, who is an obsessive accountant, sees himself as an accountant, by the way, does not see accounting as an Italian art, but one of his journeymen, he says it's because he married a Dutch woman that he really knows about accounting. He will cover every post office in the American colonies with a double entry manual. He believes this is how to found a country. That's in my book. There are many more details about that. It's quite remarkable. There are actual methods that work, and these methods, when they start and begin and don't perhaps completely flower, in certain places, we see the same things that are part of a tradition which is recognized, taken up, for example, in the American colonies, remarkably by geniuses like Franklin, who understand that this is a tradition. He understands it. He explains it. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
is still more advanced than anywhere else. As far as Protestantism goes, this is, I mean, I don't like to get into that, but there's no question. I was actually in the Rice today, looking at the pictures of the way people read. And in the Catholics have this tradition in the early Renaissance. After Trent, it starts disappearing. And the Dutch are constantly not just showing people reading, but keeping books. And that's why this is such an important thing that we have here, this movement of this painting, which is two kinds of Dutch painting. One is a reading for piety painting, and the other is a professional bookkeeping painting. And this is particularly Dutch. There is no question that within the language of, for example, the Necessary Discourse, they have a very Protestant discussion of finally just burying yourself once and for all, and making your public reckoning and getting it over with, and not having secrets and not having this idea of a divine secret. However, you know, if we move between Flemish and Dutch art, as we can do right here, I think it's a hard question that I can't answer if this is Dutch or if this is completely Protestant. I think there's a Protestant issue here. When we get to England in the 18th century, amongst the dissenters, it's not Protestant, it's specifically Low Church. Remarkable tradition. I would say this is the most important modern tradition of accounting of all, because there's no organized church. In England, you have to watch yourself, and the way the dissenters watch themselves is through keeping their accounts to see if they're chosen. And these dissenters turn into the greatest industrialists of all times. And in these religious books, they also start putting their experiments and building their companies. That's another story that's in my book. For the Dutch, I can't answer your question. I think it's very, very complicated. I mean, I think that the religious culture here is, look, Erasmus is not a Protestant. That already makes it really hard, doesn't it? This starts as a judgment picture, but this painting is stolen at sea by Polish pirates. Okay? It ends up in Dante. And Tommaso Portinari is famous for doing the two first modern business lawsuits of all time. One is over some wool, which he does the most complex business lawsuit of all time. The other is to get this painting back from Dante. It's a huge story. When this painting eventually is finished, he is finally dishonored. When it's started, he is actually still a rich man. When it's done, it becomes about accountability. It starts about judgment, but as his position changes, the meaning of the painting changes. So Memling is not necessarily painting about accountability, but he is painting a warning that even Portinari recognizes. He will be judged, okay? He is an accountant, that's his job. So we don't have that, the idea of painting accountants to begin with is only in the Italian and Dutch tradition. This is an Italo-Dutch painting, very unusual painting, from Bruges, very unusual place, for the Medici banking, and this painting will have many different lives and meanings. So, a judgment painting that becomes an accountability painting. In retrospect, we now see it as almost a divine, you know, painting that recognizes that this man, at this very moment that he commissions this painting, made a bad loan. A very risky loan, a loan of hubris, a loan of pride to a prince. He wanted to be in the court of the prince. Now, which side will he go to? Well, we know. He goes this way. Okay?
Dave, I really liked your lecture. I also liked the article you wrote about the subject, so I really look forward to the book. But there is one slight point of unease that I had, and that is where it sometimes seemed in your lecture that advances in accounting equals double entry accounting. Of course, double entry is one technique of accounting. And quite important nowadays. If you look at the traditions of Dutch Republican government accounting, Simon Stevin writes a fantastic example of a double entry account for Maurits' domains. I think it's used for 3 or 4 years, then they switch back to Cameron style. Most government bodies that I've studied use an adaptation of Cameron style of accounting, which doesn't have to be irrational, because, I mean, double entry accounting is commercial accounting. It has a specific logic to it, which is geared to commerce. So my question is it not more the second half of the lecture, the auditing, that is the key here, than the specific accounting technique? Because this is actually the great advance that is made with the introduction of a general chamber of reckoning in 1607. It's also, it would point at one of the weaknesses of this. Auditing is done very well, but it's always done by very localized bodies, so there's a competition inbuilt there, where the various chambers of the BOC do their own auditing, but don't want the others to know, etc. This goes especially for the government as a whole.
Any accountant and scientific accountant today would actually say that I'm right, because double entry is the only one that's actually truly exact, and we don't use camera accounting in the West anymore, although it actually, a form of it is actually used in other countries still today. In this period, sure, absolutely. Camera roll accounting is designed, actually designed for mining industries, for certain banking industries, and for government. It's remarkable because it's designed in this practical way, in the way that Second North uses it. However, it will never bring you to the point that double entry has, and that's why again and again treatises are written in the 18th century saying we cannot be completely exact unless there is a final central ledger that is double entry, that is based on double entry ledgers that come beneath it. So there is a sense among mathematical scientists that double entry is the most exact. That is not to say that cameralist accounting doesn't work incredibly well for a certain time. It will be done away with in the modern times. So we could argue about that for the sense of my necessary discourse. Yes, I agree with you partially, but I still stand by double entry, as most of the mathematicians probably did too. For the practical matters at the time, yeah, there are many cases where cameralism will work very, very well and is used. But the idea is double entry. And also double entry has the remarkable moral metaphor of that balance, which is used in literature all the time, the way they talk about the credits and the debits. And by the way, everyone from Shakespeare will talk about credits and debits to religious moralists. And this goes into the 19th century. So I do think that to look at the tradition in a genealogical way for an intellectual historian, double entry is more helpful. It is not the only part of the story. Absolutely.
Could we actually in some centralization, at least I know that Stevin was trying to bring a lot of organizations together in one building. He was a private tutor, so now it's also trying to handle this. The problems with decentralization to a certain extent by providing more power to the powers and teaching them that. So I was also wondering, even if there is this whole culture of accounting, whether it's double entry bookkeeping, it's something, a way actually not to decentralize, but to centralize.
Yes. So, yeah, absolutely. It's actually seen theoretically. There are numerous treatises, especially in the 18th century, that the idea, it goes beyond this. The idea of a central government is actually represented by a single central ledger. We have this, as we talked about yesterday, not only in general in 1340, but the Federalists in the United States actually say, look, we cannot be a country without a single ledger, because unless we have a good single ledger, we cannot get foreign loans. Those are things that the states can exist alone doing their own lousy accounting will fail. If America is to be a country, it must have a central government, it must have a central ledger. It says this in the Federalist Papers, it's an amazing moment. So it has as great force, this idea.
And did you know that the firm of Oak and Company was the holder of total American foreign debt at one time? So that was a two-sided thing between the United States.
Well, the United States.
The
United States is born into debt. It's the whole reason the country there is because the French give America 3 million livres. That's why Hamilton is brought in. They're terrified because they don't know how to pay it back, and then the French will actually take the United States back as collateral. And this is why the federalism comes about, and that's why within the Federalist paper, the concept, and I've talked about this with Jack Ratcliffe, I think the finest thinker of the Federalist idea, who's at Stanford, and he says that behind the thinking, it's not the only thinking, but behind it is the logic of the single ledger, because these guys are actually, in many cases, trained accountants from the Caribbean, or two of them. It's amazing stuff.
We can take one final question. Leave Marie-Laine.
Thank you. I hope you enjoyed your lecture a lot. There was also one point I wasn't sure whether it really is necessary to emphasize it, that so much because you were saying about what you were talking about, the discontinuity between the Italian system and then the rise of the Dutch system. And although that may be true in some respects, I think knowledge doesn't necessarily come from theoretical books. I think that a lot of the practices from double accounting was learned by young merchants going to Italy.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Right, but this is absolutely true, and it brings that back. If it actually trains in Venice, right, then I think that John Newman writes the first manual. Many of these reckoning masters are coming from the Italian world. However, the Italians don't ever come up with any thought around it. And that staggers me, because that's what the Renaissance is all about, are how to do it books by the Italians. The only books is this book by, well, there's Domenico Manzoni's 1540 book. This is not a book that has a great echo. So yes, this is a tradition which physically comes via Italy, but it is not actually seen as a tradition until the Dutch call it that. The Dutch actually use it in this greater scaffolding of political and administrative thought. That's the sort of change. Because you can have a practice on one end, fine, that the Italians do. You put it into the Dutch context, it becomes a completely different animal when it becomes part of political theory. Does that answer the question at all?
Yeah, well, I don't think there is so much, it's really so much difference between the accountability of Italian civil states governments and the accountability of the Dutch states general.
Think of Rome in 1498. Think of the great merchant families of Rome starting to figure out now that they're going to buy titles of nobility in this new monarchical world that they're in, and actually starting to hide their knowledge of accounting. They still need it, they're still making money, but they're trying to move out and become noble. I've actually studied this. It's a remarkable thing to see. By the way, Cosimo de' Medici will already make the differentiation. He will train one son to learn double entry, Piero de' Galli, which is a disaster because he dies. There's another son that knows a little bit about it. When we get to Lorenzo the Magnificent, he cannot audit a book. He allows this guy named Sassetti to do it, but Sassetti becomes a Neoplatonist and he drops the books. He's the one that takes the flak for this. He has to actually go to Lyon and he comes back broke. That's another story told by the great Belgian historian Raymond de Ruyter's wife, who actually did all the work for him in my favorite article about accounting, which she did, I believe, in 1941. About the Sassetti ledger. By the way, I just got, for the first time ever, a picture of where Sassetti makes the wrong balance for the Medici Bank that spells the end for the Medici Bank. It's on the computer, but it's a beautiful image.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.